Hi friends, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts. I am Dr. Srinivas, neurophysician from Andhra Pradesh, India. I am also the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. Today we are going to talk about a very fascinating topic, the visual fields, papilledema and visual agnosia. Basically, we are going to talk about the second nerve, the optic nerve. So, if a person comes with visual disturbance, how are we going to approach? Visual processing is complex, challenging, but very fascinating. So much so that 50% of the brain is involved in the processing of vision. 50% of the brain is involved in vision. So when a person comes with a visual disturbance, we first need to understand whether it's a neurological cause or a refractory cause. How do we differentiate? We ask him to look through a pinhole. If by looking through the pinhole, if vision gets corrected, it's a refractory error. If it doesn't get corrected, it's a neurological disorder. So, talking about visual fields, we need to understand what is actually visual field. Visual field is the limit of the periphery wherein an object can be seen when the eyes are fixed. So, what is visual field? Visual field is the limit of the peripheral vision in the area wherein you can see an object while the eyes are fixed. That is visual field. But to understand visual field, papilledema and visual agnosia, we need to know certain basics. Now let's see the basics. First of all, we need to know what fundus is, what macula is, and what is papillomacular bundle. What is fundus? Fundus is the visual part of the optic nerve. So fundus is the visual part of the optic nerve. It has no receptor cells. Fundus has no receptor cells. Because it has got no receptor cells, it is responsible for the physiological blind spot because there are no receptor cells. And since fundus is placed medially to the macula, nasal to the macula, the physiological blind spot is displaced temporarily. And it is the only part of the body wherein you can see the vessels directly. So fundus is the only part of the body wherein you can see the vessels directly. So fundus is the visible portion of the optic nerve. It has got no receptor cells and therefore it is responsible for the physiological blind spot, which is pushed temporally because it is nasal to the macula, and fundus is the only part of the body wherein you can see the vessels directly by using ophthalmoscope. Fine. Now let's see macula. Macula is placed temporal to the optic fundus. Macula contains cones. So cones are responsible for color vision and acuity of vision. So the highest number of cones are seen in the macula. So macula is responsible for the greatest acuity of vision. Macula is responsible for the greatest acuity of vision, for color vision, and then macula is the point of central fixation. Very important. Macula is the point of central fixation, not the fundus. Macula is the point of central fixation. So how can we find out macula? Throw a light and ask him to look at the light. So as the person looks, it's a macula which is trying to focus on the light. So these are the important points of macula. Right. Now, there is a bundle connecting the macula to the fundus, which is known as a papillomacular bundle. So papillomacular bundle connects macula to the fundus. It is susceptible to toxins, ischemia and pressure, papillomacular bundle. And it also contains nerve fiber layer or arcuate fibers, which if it gets affected, person will develop arcuate scotomas, example glaucoma. So the papillomacular bundle also contains arcuate fibers, which usually gets affected in glaucoma, resulting in arcuate scotomas. Fine. With this basic understanding, now let's move further on. Again, to understand the fundus, we need to know the blood supply of the fundus and the nerve subarachnoid space by which we can explain papilledema. So if we take the retina, if we take the optic nerve, the covering, you have the retina and the choroid. These structures are supplied by ophthalmic artery. These structures are supplied by ophthalmic artery. But here is a very important concept. The central retinal artery comes out from the ophthalmic artery and supplies retina. It is the central retinal artery which supplies the retina. It does not supply the choroid. The central retinal artery supplies only the retina. It does not supply the choroid. In fact, choroid is supplied by the posterior ciliary artery. Why is this important? This is important to understand a very important concept, a frequently asked MCQ question, cherry red spot. Cherry red spot is seen only in central retinal artery occlusion, not in ophthalmic artery occlusion. Why? The central retinal artery supplies retina only, not the choroid. Choroid is supplied by the posterior ciliary artery, a branch of ophthalmic artery. So when the central retinal artery gets occluded, the retina gets affected. But the choroid is very much well seen because it is supplied by the posterior ciliary artery. And therefore, as the retina gets faded, the choroidal vessels are well seen. So that is cherry red spot. So cherry red spot is seen only in central retinal artery occlusion, not in ophthalmic artery occlusion. Very important point. Then the ophthalmic artery, a branch of internal carotid artery, can get affected. The nerves can get affected and person can develop amaurosis fugax. As if the curtain comes and falls down, person starts losing vision. So if a person has got amaurosis fugax, it's a warning sign of an impending internal carotid artery stroke. Right. An ischemic artery neuropathy, ION, usually causes altitudinal defect. The inferior quadrants get affected because they are watershed area. So AI, anterior ischemic neuropathy, usually affects the inferior quadrant, altitudinal defect, because it's a watershed area. Right. Now let's try to understand the concepts of papilledema. So as the optic nerve comes from the brain and goes towards the eye, the arachnoid matter also follows the optic nerve. So as the optic nerve comes, the arachnoid matter also follows the optic nerve and comes. And you have central retinal artery, central retinal vein in the center of the nerve. So when the pressure in the brain gets increased, the intracranial pressure, when it rises, it is transmitted through this subarachnoid space because it is a continuation of the brain. So when the subarachnoid space, there is a lot of pressure and edema in it, it cannot expand further and therefore it goes and starts compressing the optic nerve. See, the subarachnoid space is placed peripheral to the optic nerve. So when the intracranial pressure is raised, it is transmitted through the subarachnoid space. So the pressure in the subarachnoid space increases and therefore it goes and compresses the optic nerve. Once the optic nerve is compressed, the axoplasma flow is disrupted. there is swelling of the axons, there is disruption, and therefore there is edema. So this is the pathogenesis of papilledema. So when there is an increased intracranial pressure, it is transmitted through the subarachnoid space. So this goes and compresses the optic nerve. The axonal flow gets disrupted. The axoplasma flow gets disrupted. There is axonal swelling and edema. And since it is going bilaterally to both areas, papilledema is usually bilateral in persons with raised intracranial pressure. So another important point, papilledema is bilateral in persons with raised intracranial pressure, because pressure goes to both the subarachnoid spaces following the optic nerves, it compresses, and therefore you see papilledema in both eyes. So papilledema is bilateral in persons with raised intracranial pressure. So the classic example is space occupying lesion. Any space occupying lesion can increase the intracranial pressure and disrupt the, increase the pressure in the subarachnoid space and compress the optic nerve. So what are all the clinical manifestations of papilledema? As I said, the ophthalmic artery divides into posterior ciliary artery supplying the choroid and the central retinal artery which supplies the retina. Along with there is central retinal vein. And therefore when the pressure increases, when the subarachnoid space goes and compresses the optic nerve, it also compresses the central retinal artery. The veins also get compressed. So absence of spontaneous venous pulsations are the earliest findings of papilledema. Because the vessels are compressed, no longer you can see the spontaneous venous pulsations. So absence of spontaneous venous pulsation is the earliest finding in papilledema. Second, the fundus bulges because of the bilateral papilledema, because of the edema compression, the disruption of the axoplasma flow and the edema. There's an edema in the fundus. So the fundus actually responds, since there are no receptor cells, it actually responds the physiological blind spot. So as there is edema, the physiological blind spot which is placed peripherally, the representation, there's an enlargement of the blind spot. So one, there is an absence of spontaneous venous pulsation. Second, there is enlargement of physiological blind spot. And third, because of this edema, when there is movement of the head, there will be blindness coming and going. So when there is movement of the head, the vision also gets affected. This is also another important sign of papilledema. So episodic blindness related to head movements. And then we have sixth cranial nerve involvement. So you have bilateral abducens nerve palsy, wherein person cannot look laterally. Why is usually the sixth nerve involved in raised ICT? It's a long nerve, it's a thin slender nerve. And when there's raised ICT, when the pressure gets affected, the brainstem gets involved and it can push against the petrous part of the temporal bone. So the sixth nerve gets compressed, jammed between the petrous part of the temporal bone and the brainstem, and therefore sixth nerve is usually involved. It could be a false localizing sign because the pressure is somewhere and the sixth nerve gets affected somewhere else. So it could be a false localizing sign. So, but it is usually seen in persons with raised ICT. What happens to the vision? Will the vision get affected? As I said, the vision, the main focus, the main area which is responsible, the highest or the greatest visual acuity is macula, not the fundus. In fact, fundus has got no receptors. So it is the macula which has got the highest number of cones and highest and the greatest visual acuity. So as long as the macula is not affected, papilledema or the fundus involvement will not affect vision. So vision will be normal in persons with papilledema. So visual acuity is preserved in persons with papilledema. Right. Now let's see what happens if the nerve gets involved, optic nerve. Generally, optic neuritis, generally it does not involve the anterior most part of the nerve. It involves slightly portion which is peripheral to the anterior portion of the nerve, and therefore usually optic neuritis does not affect the fundus, and therefore when the doctor examines, the fundus is usually normal. But since the optic nerve is affected, person is not able to see. So very interesting comparison. Here is the person who cannot see because optic nerve is involved, and when the doctor examines, he does not find any visual finding because the fundus is normal, because optic nerve is usually backwards to the fundus, and therefore the patient sees nothing, and when examined, the doctor also sees nothing. So easy way to remember: doctor sees nothing and patient sees nothing. And usually they'll have central scotomas. The macula is responsible for vision, and optic nerve is basically concerned with color. And therefore, when there is optic neuropathy or when the optic nerve gets affected, the color, the appreciation of color, the color perception is gone. Dyschromatopsia. So, how do we differentiate whether optic nerve is involved or macula is involved? The two important points by which we can differentiate whether the macula is involved or the optic nerve is involved is that macula is concerned with vision, highest, greatest acuity of vision. So when the macula gets affected, vision is usually lost. Whereas the optic nerve is primarily concerned with color. So when the optic nerve gets affected, color is lost. Another important point by which we can differentiate is the photostress test. What is this photostress test? Macula, you have the receptors, and therefore you measure the visual acuity, and then you throw light. When you throw light on the macula, the receptors gets bleached, and therefore the visual acuity falls down. Only after 10 seconds it again regains its lost visual acuity. Whereas in optic nerve pathology, this optic stress, the photostress test is normal. So photostress test is abnormal in macula, whereas photostress test is normal in optic nerve. In fact, when conditions like macular degeneration, it can prolong for few minutes also, photostress test. So photostress test is the diminishing visual acuity when light is thrown, and regaining of visual acuity after few seconds. This is photostress test. So photostress test is abnormal in macula, whereas it is normal in optic nerve conditions. Right. Now we'll come to the visual fields. So visual fields, how do we approach? Visual fields we can approach by three broad categories. One, pre-chiasmal lesions. Second, chiasmal lesions. Third, post-chiasmal lesions. So how do we approach visual field defects? One, pre-chiasmal lesions. Second, chiasmal lesions. Third, post-chiasmal lesions. What is this chiasma and optic chiasma? The nasal, we have eye going on to the occipital cortex, which tries to analyze the vision. From the eye, through the retina optic fundus, it goes to the visual cortex. So from the eye, you have nasal fibers and temporal fibers. The representation is opposite to the actual direction of the fibers. That is, the nasal fibers represent temporal field and temporal fibers represent nasal field. Likewise, if you see the Mayer's loop or the radiations, optic radiations, the superior or temporal, the superior or the parietal fibers represent inferior quadrants, or the inferior or temporal fibers represent superior quadrants. Likewise, left occipital cortex represents right side of the vision, and right side of the cortex corresponds to the left side of the vision. So it is just opposite. So in the eye, you have the nasal fibers and the temporal fibers coming up. Nasal fibers and temporal fibers, right side and left side. The nasal fibers, they cross over and then go to the opposite side, whereas temporal fibers come straight away ipsilaterally, and then they go from the optic chiasma, they travel through the optic tract, lateral geniculate body, optic radiations, and finally they go to the occipital cortex. This is the visual pathway, the second nerve. So from the eye, the nasal fibers represent temporal field, temporal fibers represent nasal field, the temporal fibers cross in the optic chiasma, goes to the opposite side, the temporal fibers do not cross, they come, they go to the optic tract, lateral geniculate body, optic radiations, and to the occipital cortex. Fine. So this optic chiasma is the central point. Anything anterior to the optic chiasma we call as pre-chiasmatic lesion, or optic chiasma as chiasmatic lesions, and beyond chiasma going to the occipital cortex as post-chiasmatic lesions. So now let's see what are the features of pre-chiasmatic, chiasmatic, and post-chiasmatic lesions. In pre-chiasmatic lesions, it is monoocular, because only at the level of the optic chiasma the fibers cross and then go to the opposite side. But before the chiasma, both the nasal fibers and temporal fibers are on the same side. So in the pre-chiasmatic lesions, it is only monoocular field defects. Only from chiasma and beyond going peripherally, you will have binocular loss of visual fields. So pre-chiasma, it is only visual loss only on one eye, monoocular visual loss. So you have monoocular visual loss. You can see only visual loss in one eye. The other is completely normal. And then the optic nerves, visual fibers are 80% and pupillary fibers are as much as 20%. And therefore, in pre-chiasmatic lesion, the pupillary fibers get affected. You can have afferent pupillary defect. Then, as I said, the visual field defect, you have scotomas. Cecal scotoma, central scotoma, or centrocecal scotomas. And then the disc may or may not be involved. As I said, usually if it is optic neuritis, it usually does not involve the fundus. It is just beyond it, distal to it. And therefore, fundus may or may not be involved. Right. These are the findings of the pre-chiasmatic lesions. When you come to the chiasma, what happens? I said the nasal fibers cross and go to the opposite side. But it does not cross. What happens? It does not cross immediately. It comes, it goes slightly again to the opposite side and then descends. It comes, slightly ascends to the opposite side and then descends. And therefore, when there is a lesion here, you have a scotoma, very interesting scotoma known as junctional scotoma. In fact, this fiber going to the nasal side ascending and descending, you call it as Willebrand's knee. And therefore, when there is a lesion here in the optic chiasma, this fiber is affected and the nasal component gets affected. So, on the opposite side, there is a temporal field defect. So, on the same side, there is a complete visual loss, but on the opposite side, there is a temporal visual loss. So this is known as junctional scotoma. So junctional scotoma is found at the level of the chiasma because of the Willebrand's knee affection. And second thing, when the optic chiasma gets affected, the nasal fibers have crossed over, but the temporal fibers go ipsilaterally. So what happens? You have bitemporal hemianopia. The nasal fibers have crossed over, but the temporal fibers are there. So when the optic chiasma gets affected, both the nasal fibers get affected, and therefore you will have bitemporal hemianopia. So clinically, there are neurologists who can diagnose without CT and MRI a case of pituitary adenoma by checking out their fields. If there is bitemporal hemianopia, it is pituitary adenoma. But there are other conditions also wherein the optic chiasma can get affected. Easy to remember is PAT. Just touching a person like this with affection. PAT. P-A-T. P-A-T is an acronym by which we can remember the causes of optic chiasma involvement. What is P? P is for pituitary adenoma. The commonest cause of optic chiasma involvement is pituitary adenoma. A is for aneurysm of the internal carotid artery. Internal carotid artery is also close to the optic chiasma, and therefore there is an aneurysm of internal carotid artery can affect the optic chiasma and can cause optic chiasmal lesions. So A is for aneurysm of the internal carotid artery. T is for tumors. It could be craniopharyngioma, it could be optic nerve glioma, or it could be meningioma. So the lesions affecting optic chiasma are PAT. P for pituitary adenoma, A for aneurysm of the internal carotid artery, T for tumors, craniopharyngioma, optic nerve glioma, or meningioma. Fine. And then when we come to the post chiasmatic lesion, we have optic tract, lateral geniculate body, optic radiations, and occipital cortex. Optic tract and lateral geniculate body, you need to understand a very important concept, commonly asked MCQ question also. Optic tract and lateral geniculate body, especially optic tract lesions, produces incongruous hemianopia. What is incongruous hemianopia? On both sides, the visual loss is not same. If both the visuals, both sides, the visual loss is same, you call that as congruous hemianopia. You see that as you come posterior, like optic radiations or occipital cortex, the more the posterior, the more the congruities. The more the anterior, the more incongruities. So in optic tract and lateral geniculate body, especially optic tract, you find incongruous hemianopia. The distribution of visual loss on both sides are not equal. Why is it so? It is because of the concept retino-optic organization. Retino-optic organization. Usually the organization is maintained. Upper fibers are upper, lower fibers are lower, and they keep on going likewise. But in optic tract and lateral geniculate body, there is a mix. Because of this mix, there is incongruity, especially in the optic tract. That's a very important point. And then you have choroidectomies. As I said, from the optic tract and lateral geniculate body, the radiations go to the parietal cortex and occipital cortex. Some fibers go through the temporal lobe and the occipital cortex. So the parietal lobe is placed superiorly. So that the parietal radiations which are placed superiorly will cause inferior choroidectomies, and the inferior fibers, the temporal fibers which are placed inferiorly, will cause superior choroidectomies. So choroidectomies are very common in optic radiations, right? And then once you come to the occipital lobe, there are two important clinical points, concepts one need to know. The macula goes to the posterior most part, which is called as occipital pole. So the macula goes to the posterior most part of the occipital cortex, called as occipital pole. Whereas the nasal fibers, which represent the temporal field, end very much anteriorly, forwards. So the nasal fibers, which represent temporal field, will end very much anteriorly, in a forward direction. And it is monocular, only one side. And therefore, if there is a lesion here, the temporal visual loss will be there, what you call as temporal crescent, the more the anterior in the occipital cortex. The more posterior the lesion is, especially the occipital pole, the macula gets affected. Macula is represented in the posterior most pole, is the posterior most part of the occipital lobe. But when there is a PCA involvement, posterior cerebral artery involvement, usually there will be occipital cortex involved, but usually macula is not involved. The macula is not involved. Why macula is not involved? There are two reasons. One, macula has got extensive blood supply. One, it is not only supplied by the posterior cerebral artery, but it may also get blood supply from the middle cerebral artery and to some extent anterior cerebral artery. And therefore, macula is not usually involved because of its extensive blood supply. And second, macula has got an extensive representation. So, unless there is a big lesion, usually macula does not get affected. So usually macula is spared in occipital lobe lesions. Macula is the area which represents the central part of the vision. So usually they will have same homonymous hemianopia, but the center part of the vision is spared. What you call as macula sparing, right? But in conditions like head injury, where person can get hit in the occipital lobe, the posterior most part, the occipital pole gets affected. It can get affected, and the macula can get affected. So the center of the vision may be lost. Macula represents the central vision. So the central part may be lost. You call that as a macular involvement. So generally macula is not involved, what you call as macular sparing. But in conditions like head injury, when it hits the posteriormost part of the occipital lobe, the pole can get affected, the macula can get affected, the central part of the vision is lost. What you call as tunnel vision. So they will see, the generally there is a macular sparing and the central vision is spared. But here the central vision is lost. You have a very important point, tunnel vision and funnel vision. Funnel vision is that when you come backwards, your field of vision starts expanding. When you come backwards, the field of vision starts expanding. But in persons who are psychiatric, who are functional, they say they only see in the central part, and even when they come back, it does not expand, it remains the same. This is known as tunnel vision. They see only in the central part. Right. So funnel vision, tunnel vision. Right. Now, having understood all the pre-chiasmatic, chiasmatic and post-chiasmatic lesions, now let's see visual agnosia. What happens when it comes to the visual cortex and what will be the visual field defects? Here, we need to understand two important concepts. One, you have occipitotemporal fibers. Second, occipitoparietal projections. The occipitotemporal cortex projections and occipitoparietal projections. So if these get affected, you develop an entity known as visual agnosia. What is visual agnosia? Despite the eye apparatus, the peripheral organs being normal, if the person is not able to analyze that particular sensory perception, then you call that agnosia. For example, the auditory apparatus is normal, he is not able to hear, you call that as auditory agnosia. The olfactory system is normal, still person is not able to feel, appreciate the smell, olfactory agnosias. So vision, the eye apparatus is normal, if the person is still not able to appreciate the vision well, you call that as visual agnosia. It is the higher level of processing involvement. So this is visual agnosia. So when the occipital lobe gets affected, person's vision gets disturbed. There are two ways the vision can get disturbed. One you call it as what, second you call it as where. So the occipitotemporal projections will affect what? It is subserved by P pathway. P stands for parvocellular, which is small. So here in occipitotemporal lesions, what is affected? What? So if I see face, I can't appreciate what is the identity of the person by looking at the face. So what is lost? So person cannot identify faces. What you call as prosopagnosia. He may identify the person by the way he talks, by the way he walks, but looking at the face, he can't identify. So this is known as prosopagnosia. The what is gone. And second thing, they cannot appreciate what of objects, what of shapes. And therefore, if they are shown lot of vehicles also, they think all are of all the same brand. The shapes they cannot appreciate. And second important point is the color processing is also affected, dyschromatopsia. All the colored elements appear black and white. So a person plays a game, all the equipment or all the necessary things involved in the game may appear black and white instead of the colored objects. If you see a colored film, it may appear like a black and white. So if this is the case, if there is a color being affected, then you have to suspect occipitotemporal lesions. I would like to remind you and re-emphasize, reaffirm that color is also perceived by optic nerve. If the optic nerve gets affected, color gets affected. If the macula gets affected, vision gets affected. Likewise, in the occipital lobe, you have occipitotemporal projections, occipitoparietal projections. If occipitotemporal projections get affected, the color is affected. Right. Then you have occipitoparietal connections. Occipitoparietal connections are for where, the space, the movement. So occipitoparietal is carried by M pathway, magnocellular pathway. It is large. It is for motion, the relationship, the space. So if the occipitoparietal lesions get affected, especially if it is bilateral, and more so if the right side get affected, you get a very interesting entity known as Anten syndrome, denial of blindness. Very interesting. We may wonder that either they should have vision or they should not have vision. But here is a very interesting person who does not have vision but still thinks that he's got vision, and he moves about and he starts hitting against all the things which comes in his way. So he does not accept the fact that he is blind. Denial of illness, which is known as Anten syndrome. What is the pathophysiological basis of Anten syndrome? Denial of blindness. As I said, this is an occipitoparietal connections. Bilateral lesions, especially right-sided lesions, non-dominant lesions, they'll have hemineglect. So much so that in a very extreme case, they deny the existence of the illness, non-dominant parietal lesions. So much so that if there's a severe degree, they deny the existence of the illness, what you call as anosognosia. So it is similar to anosognosia. Anosognosia, they deny the existence of illness, but since it is extended to the occipital lobe, here they deny the existence of their visual loss. So denial of blindness is Anten syndrome. Very interesting. Compare Anten syndrome, denial of blindness, with anosognosia, denial of illness. Both are in the non-dominant parietal lobe. When it extends to occipital lobe, they deny existence of blindness. And another interesting phenomenon is balance syndrome. If occipitoparietal lobe gets affected, you have balance syndrome, optic ataxia, oculomotor apraxia, and simultagnosia. Optic ataxia is that inability to reach a particular point using their vision. So, inability to reach a particular point using their vision. Again, a very interesting and important and fascinating concept. How do you differentiate optic ataxia from cerebellar ataxia? Cerebellar ataxia with eyes open or with eyes closed, they cannot touch the finger with the to the nose. They keep shaking. But optic ataxia is not able to reach the particular point with the vision. So, as long as with the vision, cerebellar with the eyes open or with eyes closed, they cannot. But optic ataxia with eyes closed, they may be able to perform. Only with when the eyes open, they'll have difficulty. So with the eyes closed, they will be able to do it perfectly. When the eyes open only, they get confused. So optic ataxia, cerebellar ataxia. Cerebellar ataxia with eyes open or eyes closed, they'll have difficulty. Whereas optic ataxia with eyes open, they'll have difficulty. But with eyes closed, they can perform the act well. Then oculomotor apraxia. Oculomotor apraxia is tracking the event. So when it gets affected, when the parietal occipital cortex gets affected, they cannot trace it. They cannot track it. And the third very interesting phenomenon is simultagnosia. Simultagnosia is person cannot integrate the center of the vision with the peripheral of the vision. They cannot see the picture in its entirety. They will miss the forest for the tree. If they are asked to look at the forest, they will be only looking at the tree. They will not be looking at the forest. So how do we check clinically? Very interesting. You put big letters A and small letters A. Generally, anybody will be able to see the big letters A and they can insert it. But very fascinating, persons with balance syndrome and asymultagnosia, though they look at A, since their vision falls in the center only, they think the big A is as a horizontal line or oblique line, and therefore they don't realize it is a letter A. But the small letters will fall in the center of their vision and they will encircle it. So generally we will be able to look at big letters, but here simultagnosia, asymultagnosia, they will be only looking at the small letters. They cannot look at the big letters and appreciate it because they cannot integrate the center of the vision with the peripheral of vision. So if a person has got asymultagnosia, optic ataxia and oculomotor apraxia, it is balance syndrome. So in this lecture, I gave an overview of the papilledema, visual field defects and visual agnosias. Basically, I was talking about the second now, originating from the fundus, retina, going to the occipital cortex. I really enjoyed giving the lecture and I thought I tried to cover a maximum number of important concepts, and I've enjoyed giving the lecture. I hope you've also enjoyed listening to my lecture. If you have enjoyed listening to my lecture, kindly like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my FB page, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Thank you. Bye.